We all grow up. Well, most of us anyway.
Dad, what are you doing? It's Shark Week!
But the process is never easy. We look to books and movies for guidance and lessons on how to get through this thing called life. Which is why coming-of-age stories continue to resonate. But why? What's their secret? The time has come to know your genre. Rites of Passage. Before we get started, subscribe and click the bell for more filmmaking videos. We will be spoiling the following movies. Now, let's talk about growing up.
I need time to grow up.
In Blake Snyder's Save the Cat Goes to the Movies, he lays out the essential elements of 10 different genres. In this video, we'll take a look at his take on coming-of-age stories, which he calls Rites of Passage. Perhaps no other type of story is as universal, beyond nationality, time period, or economic status. Life presents everyone with a series of obstacles we must overcome. As Snyder puts it, from puberty to midlife to death, these passages await us all. And just like life, only when the hero embraces his true self, warts and all, can the torment end. When we hear coming-of-age movies, we tend to think about teenage characters entering adulthood. But Snyder breaks Rites of Passage down into five types, covering a spectrum of life experiences. The midlife passage finds characters in the crisis of adulthood.
So what are you doing here?
A couple of things. Taking a break from my wife, forgetting my son's birthday, and getting paid $2 million to endorse a whiskey when I could be doing a play somewhere.
The separation passage centers on the fallout of divorce.
And I don't love you anymore.
Where are you going?
I don't know.
The adolescent passage marks the transition out of childhood.
It's just that I'm not ready to be a mom.
Damn Skippy, you're not. You don't even remember to give Liberty Bell her breathing meds.
That was once, and she did not die, if you recall.
The addiction passage chronicles battles with substance abuse.
I think I always liked it.
What?
Anything, pot, alcohol, ecstasy, cocaine, LSD.
And the death passage involves characters facing the end for themselves or others.
Sorry for wasting your money on expensive private schools. Money you could have been using on facials and massages and sports equipment. Sorry for everything.
These transformative moments are easily combined, and we often see hybrids. 13 deals with adolescence and addiction.
Hey, no more than one, you got homework.
They were removing asbestos from the locker room today, so, ow! We got the whole gym period to do our homework.
Separation stories like Scenes from a Marriage often overlap with midlife crises. Each of these subtypes shares three components. The life problem, the wrong way to handle it, and a solution found only through acceptance. Let's start with the problem. Divorce, addiction, or a good old-fashioned midlife crisis all provide rich and dramatic storytelling material. Confronting death might be the ultimate source of existential dilemma.
Hey, listen. Don't you worry about me, Hazel Grace, okay? I'm gonna find a way to hang around here and annoy you for a long time.
The same might be said for confronting high school. Pressure, abuse, popularity, abandonment, expectations. It is truly a trial by fire.
Well, if you just answer the question.
Why don't you just answer the question?
Be honest.
No big deal.
Yeah, answer it.
Just answer the question, Claire.
Talk to us.
Come on,
answer the question. Don't be a jerk.
Come on, it's easy. It's only one question.
No! I never did it!
No matter the individual conflict or obstacle, Snyder argues that the remedy is rarely obvious. Often, the problem is one that offers no real action to solve. This easy answer is never apparent to the hero. But the journey to that discovery is what drives the character forward. In Birdman, Riggin is having an existential crisis. Will he find artistic fulfillment doing the play? Or should he return to the role that put him on the map?
Give the people what they want. Some good old-fashioned apocalyptic porn. Birdman, the Phoenix Rises. Pimple-faced gamers screaming in their pants. 1 billion worldwide, guaranteed.
In eighth grade, Kayla navigates the end of middle school the only way she knows how, through trial and error.
Like, the really awesome thing about confidence is that you can just start acting like it even if you feel like you don't have any. For example, I used to, like, not be confident at all. But then one day I'm like, I want to be confident. So then I just kind of started acting like it, and then it made me feel good, and then I actually started being confident, like, without trying.
A challenge for screenwriters working in this genre is to provide enough sympathy for the protagonist and their plight. Snyder explains, we must be given a good reason to cheer for someone whose only problem is getting through it. In Flight, Captain Whitaker is a hero.
The 102 souls on board, including the flight crew, 96 of them survived the crash.
He's also mired by substance abuse.
An initial report shows that you had alcohol in your system at a level of 0.24.
His struggles through it are balanced by our sympathy for his heroism and his ultimate decision to do the right thing.
On the morning of the accident,
I was drunk. I'm drunk now.
In Ordinary People, Conrad is tormented by the guilt he assumes for his brother's fatal accident and a strained relationship with his mother. All of this helps the audience invest in his emotional success.
Something happened.
What?
It's
what?
Oh, God.
With the problem established, the hero will inevitably pursue the solution in the wrong way. According to Snyder, having sensed the problem, yet not knowing exactly what to do about it, the hero will inevitably flail and grasp at any solution that might help. For example, in Modern Romance, after a breakup, Robert tries to distract himself by taking vitamins.
Oh, you broke up with somebody.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, you're gonna need C, magnesium.
Exercising.
One, two, three, I don't even miss it. Two, three.
And dating other people.
See, I just broke up with somebody, and it doesn't matter. I do know you. We're going to have a great time. Let's go.
In all that jazz, Joe is an alcoholic and obsessive creator who ignores serious health concerns.
Mr. Gideon is having severe attacks of angina that could possibly lead to a massive coronary.
I got to get back to rehearsals. I'm fine. What do doctors know?
About angina, just a little more than show people, Mr. Gideon.
Instead, he pours himself further into his work, only making amends after it's too late.
You had your way, now you must pay.
Much of Act Two in these films is dedicated to setting up and exploring these false remedies. As Snyder explains, the wrong way seems like a good idea, but is actually just a way of avoiding the inevitable. In Boy, Alamein mythologizes his absentee father as a great man and ends up betraying his friends to impress him.
Hey, you make sure you find any more of this, you bring it straight to me, eh?
Boy! Come move your back
up! Look what I found!
Eventually, he accepts the truth. Reality wins over fantasy.
I thought I was like you, but I'm not. I don't have any potential.
In Bridesmaids, Annie needs to take control of her spiraling life. She is honored to be chosen as the maid of honor for Lillian's wedding.
Yay, Annie!
But her jealousy and insecurity cause her to spiral further.
Ooh, delicious stupid cookie! I think I'll... Maybe it's better if I dip it in that chocolate! Oh!
On a storytelling level, this compounding of mistakes works so well because, as Snyder says, it is so human. Avoiding pain is natural, even logical, yet only the counterintuitive move of embracing pain will help. This leads us to our final element, when the character finally finds their solution through acceptance. It's basic human nature to assume that the problems or obstacles we face come from external sources, not from ourselves. As Snyder points out, the necessary revelation comes from within. The only thing that can save the hero is turning the flailing inward and realizing that he must change, not the world around him. In Young Adult, Mavis is an alcoholic writer at a crossroads. She blindly assumes that rekindling her high school romance will be the solution.
Mavis, I'm a married man.
I know. We can beat this thing together.
You're better than this.
In the end, she cuts her losses and moves forward into change.
As she boarded the train for Cambridge, she took one last look at her small town and blew it a kiss. Thinking, life, here I come.
In Trainspotting, Renton is a heroin addict trying to stay clean.
Gonna do it right this time, gonna get it sorted out, get off it for good.
I sure have heard that one before.
To do this, he must sabotage and abandon the friendships that keep dragging him back into it.
So why did I do it? I could offer a million answers, all false. The truth is that I'm a bad person, but that's going to change. I'm going to change. This is the last of that sort of thing. And I'm cleaning up and I'm moving on, going straight and choosing life. I'm looking forward to it already.
In some cases, the protagonist is able to figure out the answer to their problems on their own. Otherwise, the solution will present itself in a way that cannot be ignored. As Snyder explains, the solution must often be forced on the hero. It's been coming all along. We know it, and secretly, so do the characters. In 28 Days, it is only when Gwen is forced into recovery and exposed to the struggles of her fellow patients that she finally recognizes her need to change.
You're just in a rut. It happens to everyone.
No. Jess, there's an entire world of people out there who do everything right. They live right. They don't drink. They don't do drugs.
That's a crock of shit.
And they are happy.
They're not happy. No one adult human being is happy.
In Mrs. Doubtfire, to regain custody of his children, Daniel must prove to a judge and his ex-wife that he can become a responsible caregiver.
I'm giving you 3 months, Mr. Hillard.
Thank you.
3 months in which to get a job, keep it, and create a suitable home.
Although he tries to cheat the ruling by becoming the nanny, this forces him to grow into the ideal parent his kids need.
Dinner is served, madam.
How lovely!
Sometimes this acceptance serves as a break into the final act. Becomes the climax itself.
Maddie!
Or is saved for the very last scene.
خب تصمیم چیه خانم؟ پدر مادر گوشن به اخته خودت که تصمیم بگیر حالی که دارن جدا میشن از این وقت با کدومشون میخوای زندگی کنی؟ با بابات میخوای باشی؟ یا با مامانت؟ تصمیم تو گرفتی یا نه بابا؟
بله
بله؟
نه
Storytelling is all about change, and these Rites of Passage movies provide a natural and effective framework for stories about characters in transition. These universal problems and solutions provide not just entertainment, they are guidebooks on how to live. Which genre should we cover next? Cast your vote in the comments. If you're ready to endure the Rites of Passage in your next screenplay, start writing today in StudioBinder's screenwriting software. That's all for now. Time to make a change.
Changes. Turn and face the strain.
Changes.
Don't wanna be a richer man.
Changes.
Turn.